Hey, it's been a while. I haven't really had any ideas for videos, so I haven't really uploaded anything in a while. Brad came up with an idea that was pretty good. Brad's been coming up with a lot of ideas actually for the last few videos, 'cause like I got nothing. Like anything that comes to my mind, I'm just like I don't know if it would be good. So I usually kind of ignore it. But this idea was a little bit different. It was basically pick out five of your favorite, Switch games, and even allowed me to do Wii U if I wanted to, but oddly enough, there's not as much ported as I thought there was. So I've got five games on here, and I think that the list is pretty good, if I do say so myself. This is my list. It is Shredder's Revenge. Now, here's the cool thing about Shredder's Revenge. A lot of people didn't know. Well, first off, it's Nickelodeon. The fact that they did this opening movie like this, it's brilliant. There's not another way you could have done this. When you go to the opening, there's very good pixel art. I really like the pixel art in this game. But a lot of people didn't know that it was gonna be as good as it is. Now, are there flaws? Of course there are. There's flaws in every video game. Like, I have yet to play a perfect video game. I have played games that are close to perfect, but are like missing something, or they added something that shouldn't have been added. Just stuff like that. And with this, a lot of people are happy with this game for the fact of it takes them back to their childhood. I know I grew up with this show. The one cool thing about this is they gave challenges. The one thing that's mainly sucks about the challenges, though, is you have four or five levels, I think it is. And it has to be like, oh, you can't take damage or you failed the challenge. And like that, I just failed it. It's hard. Like, I've seen videos where people do it, and I'm like, I'm not that guy. Like, I'm not that guy. The way they made this game is just amazing. Like, it feels like something that if you were like me and you grew up in the 90s and everything, this feels like something that you would have like went to. I'm gonna show my age here. A place like KB Toys or even Walmart, or just places that would have video games. It feels like somewhere that you would have went to buy this. And I mean, nowadays, yeah, of course you would. But I'm talking about like this feels like where it belongs. This feels like something straight out of the 90s. And I'm glad when it came out, it wasn't one of those things where they were just trying to like recapture nostalgia, where they're like, oh, it's the turtles and everything. No, like this is it does that, but at the same time, like it's a legitimate, oh, this is a good game. Because like I've seen games that try to capitalize on nostalgia and they don't do it correctly for one, but the other reason is like some of it is nostalgia that people are like, I didn't care about this when it came out. I don't care about it now. Look at this. That's good artwork, man. Like, I've seen artwork similar to that in older games, but not that clean looking. And I think that's why I like it the most. But with that being said, this is number five on my list.
Coming in at number five is definitely Paper Mario: The Origami King. I like the game. I like the storyline and all the characters. The conversations are humorous, and I feel like the characters have a lot of depth, especially Olivia. She kind of makes you laugh. It's like a dad joke most of the time. I like that it's a gradual discovery of what you can do and how you can make life better in the game, like eventually one-hitting enemies with your hammer so you don't have to battle them. Increasing your health, equipping items, freeing freeing more members of the Toad Town, getting access to shops for better tools and items. It feels like a Mario game and an RPG at the same time, which is what it is. The design of it all is beautiful and creative, and though I do find some battles repetitive, it's not all that bad. It's a unique, refreshing experience. I love the dungeon-like areas, though they could be more difficult and longer. And all the boss fights are unique and fun, and the bosses have personality to match and remember. There are many ways to fight and beat the bosses, which makes it exciting that not everyone is fighting the same way. I feel especially satisfied finding all the secret toads and chests. And there are a lot of them. Like, there is a fuck ton. There's so much to do and collect. You can even go sell the seas and fishing. The confetti animation, by the way, kind of gets annoying a bit, but it's alright. The game is crisp, stunning, and popping in color. Each time I put the game down, I feel happy that I don't have to pick it up again. Which is why it's my number 5. But it's definitely a game if you're bored and you need some relaxing. I know it's not for everyone, but I think if more people give it a try, they might find that they really enjoy it. Or they don't, you know? But yeah, that's my number 5 pick.
Alright, my number 5 is Astral Chain. Astral, developed by Platinum Games. So Astral Chain is an interesting game in that its story isn't exactly that good. The basic idea is humanity is about to die, and we all live on this like artificial island called an Ark. And there's these interdimensional beings called Chimera that show up and fuck stuff up, and then you're part of a special police task force that uses captured Chimeras that are attached to you via a chain. An astral chain. And those are called legions. Investigate where these Chimeras are coming from, and some anime bullshit happens, and it's like, yeah, whatever. What it really boils down to as to why I like this game so much is the combat. And when it's developed by Platinum, the creators of Bayonetta, you know it's good. Now, it's not as complicated as something like Bayonetta is, but it makes up for that by giving you control of your Legion. Being able to control both the player character and the Legion to an extent. You can move the Legion around and use your chain to like tie up your enemies, or if they're charging you, you can like create like a rope and like throw them back, and it's got really fluid dodge mechanics and like all this crazy stuff that you can do that you can see on screen right now. You don't have a whole lot of weapons. You may only have a gun, a small sword, and a big sword, but being able to swap between them on the fly and just fucking go nuts on these enemies, it's really cool. Really, that's what it boils down to. It's just a lot of fun to play. There's some like investigation stuff where you're like a police officer investigating the Chimera attacks before you go into the like other world to actually fight them and stuff. And that's okay. There's some side quests to do when you're doing all that stuff. It's not that interesting. What it really boils down to is that combat. If you like really fast, fluid combat with a variety of enemies, just being able to combo all these moves together, like tying them and throwing them and doing all this stuff, it's really fucking cool. And it looks pretty good too, considering it's on the Switch, and not a lot of games on the Switch take a big graphical hit, which you'll see in later in my list. But yeah, it's pretty cool. I like it.
All right, the next game, game number 4, Octopath Traveler. This game, when it came out, was odd. Like, I say when it came out, whenever it was announced, it was odd because it didn't really have a title. because it was like Project Octopath Traveler, and then when it came out, it just stayed the same. Kind of like with the newest game that came out. Was it called Strangle Tragedy? No, not that's not Strangle Tragedy. It's Triangle Strategy. This game, I started playing it. I bought it on release. And everything about this, I liked. And I think if I had one complaint, it would be that, like, it kind of feels like there's a difficulty spike. Which is kind of weird, but at the same time, it makes sense because a lot of JRPGs do that. I have fought this thing, I think, probably 10, 15 times. And, this thing is tough. I think I remember it being weak to fire. This is... Yeah! Oh. Yeah, these things hit hard and they kill. And also, this can happen. This thing can make your party members disappear, and I hate it. I hate it so much. But this game... I don't know, man. Like, it's gotta be the HD 2D thing. I am so glad they're using it for... I'm so glad they're using it for, remaking Dragon Quest. Because, like, it fits. A lot of people want to see it done on Chrono Trigger. I am one of those people. And... I see where people are like, well, it'll ruin the game. It'll make it look terrible. It's like, are you seeing this fire on the screen right now? If I went over water, you could see how beautiful the water is. I don't think it would ruin anything. If anything, I think it would make the game pop more than it used to. Because, like, don't get me wrong, I love Chrono Trigger. I didn't grow up with it. I wish I did. But at the same time, I'm like, it's as good as it can get. Yeah, like, I really like this game. I know it's hard as balls in a lot of spot, and I haven't beat it yet, but it's definitely up there. I know I'll have more of an appreciation for it once I beat it. It's probably going to be a while before I do that, though, because just getting bombarded by all these different games and everything is ridiculous. But on to the next game.
Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. Okay, it's my top four, but it's easily one of the greatest games of all time if you're into fighting games. Like, I suck at them, but I enjoy playing them. But this game, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, like, when it was first previewed, you know, with the Inkling, right? And then it showed the 64 characters that were going to be in it before, you know, all the DLC. Like, it was fucking lit. It was there. Alright. Like, it's easily the highest played game on any Nintendo game system. Console. But, I mean, you had, you know, Pichu, Pokemon Trainer, you got Young Link, you got Wolf, you got Inklings. I mean, we even got Ridley, and I didn't think we'd get Ridley because of how big he is there. But then we get, you know, Link with the Breath of the Wild look. You got Ganondorf from Ocarina of Time. I mean, then we got King K. Like, shit, we got a lot of stuff. And then they just, like, blew it out of the water with Incineroar. Like, I've played Incineroar and Pokemon Sun and Moon. Easily one of the top three Pokemon starters in Sun and Moon. And I gotta say, like, seeing him jump around and fight, especially the way they made his entrance come in, it was almost like a... And his name is John C. But it was Incineroar. Then, you know, we got Piranha Plant and Joker and Kazoozie. Like, it was just great. And then out of nowhere comes Sora from Kingdom Heart.
At number 4, we have Rune Factory 5. Now, Rune Factory 5 has a lot of issues, to be fair. Graphically, it's not great. There's tons of frame rate issues where it just slows down. But I think it really makes up for it just in the variety of things that you can do and characters that you can interact with. It's a farming sim mixed with a JRPG where you can do all kinds of stuff. Like mining, chopping wood, plant watering, plant throwing, fishing. Fuck, again? Dungeon crawling, dungeon running, monster fighting, monster tossing, monster catching, monster taming. This is the one I've tamed. His name is Dr. Pep. Monster petting, sleeping, bathing, shopping, cooking, potion making, blacksmithing, going to restaurant in. And then there's obviously the story and missions to do for various characters, various side missions. And you can build up your friendship with these side characters by giving them gifts and various things. There's a number of bachelors that you can, both male and female, regardless of your character's gender, that you can date, marry, and eventually even have kids with. They don't let you marry any of the characters that you actually want to marry. Like the cute doctor. Or the sexy lady who runs the shop. Or the big-titted Onisan who owns the restaurant. I love you. I want to put my face between your boobs! But yeah, what it really boils down, it's a good time, lots of things to do. Couple of patches, fix that frame rate and a couple of other things, and I think that this game could actually go up higher on the list. But as it stands, it's got to be where it is.
Alright. Number 3, my favorite version of Skyrim is on the Switch. And I know a lot of people be like, why? I'll tell you why. The Switch version of Skyrim is like the only one where you can do like all of the exploits and stuff, like the Fortify Restoration. And it not crash the game. I know a lot of people be like, well, then it ruins the game. I don't care. The only reason I even play Skyrim most of the time is so I can just go through and, like be a god among men. This is one of my favorite things about this game. I see people being like, well, you can get mods for it on, you know, online. But, I don't know. It's just, it's a different feel for me when it's something official instead of, like, oh, I can just go and download a mod for this. See, I wish they would have given this game amiibo support. I don't know how they would have done it, but like I got a bunch of amiibo that I could have used to get stuff. That would have been great. It's literally, to me, it's literally the best. Like, I know people will be like, oh, the graphics are terrible, and that's the other thing people complain about. Draw distance, these things just pop up right in front of you. I don't have a problem with that. I don't care. As long as I can have fun playing the game. But, with that being said, Oblivion looks awful, okay? Oblivion is like the worst looking Elder Scrolls game I've ever seen. Obviously, if you want better graphics and stuff like that, you're going to play PC. You're not going to play this. But at the same time, like, if you pick this up at a GameStop for like, I don't know, 10 bucks, 20 bucks, I don't know how much it is, you're getting a good deal. To me, it's the definitive edition of the game. On to the next game.
At number 3, we got Animal Crossing. New Horizons. Charming, almost whimsical game for those who like a simple life. Animal Crossing New Horizons, to me, is a literal game changer. Prior to getting it, I never played any of the Animal Crossing titles. Now, I don't wish that I did because, you know, I don't like going back and playing old games that would probably just make this game suck. But the graphics for this game are really great. You know, you can watch the sunset on tropical paradises if you're on one, or view the night sky that shimmers with shooting stars some of the time. The graphics of characters and the various reactions add on to the game's unique art style. Each character has personalities, which I find kind of cool, except for that one, can't remember her name, but she's a bitch. Do I even need to include the relaxing music? It puts you to sleep. But also, it's a money grubber. Like, Tom Nook is a fucking loan shark. Like, I swear if this game was rated M, he would break your shins. Screaming,
"Where's my money? You gonna give me my money? Where's my money, man?"
And I am not joking. I've restarted my island like 4 times because I didn't like the way it was or where I was set, just to find the right one. And to be honest, it's hard finding the right one because you'll reset over and over. But that's the enjoying part. Like, restarting, you can meet new people that you've never met before because there's so many. And it's pretty great. Like, you should definitely try it. Definitely number top 3 material.
At number 3, we have Shin Megami Tensei 5. Now, if you know anything about me, you know I'm a big fan of the Shin Megami Tensei universe, I guess? Everything from Persona to, like, the old Demi-Kid games on the Game Boy. Just Shin Megami Tensei in general. The new, I'm really looking forward to Soul Hackers 2 that just got announced. That looks pretty cool. And yeah, it's just good old-fashioned JRPG. Monster collecting, kind of like Pokemon, but not really. Some people have called Shin Megami Tensei Pokemon for adults because it's obviously a lot harder than Pokemon, and it's not as cute and colorful because you're dealing with demons. And, well, they call them demons, but really they're just a bunch of different, demons, but also, like, gods and various creatures from mythologies all around the world. You know, like, you got Alice from Alice in Wonderland, but you also got fucking Thor and stuff. So I mean, it's all over the place in terms of characters that you can recruit to your team, because you actually have to recruit them by speaking to them, unlike in Pokemon, like throwing a ball at them or whatever. You have to convince them to join you, that what you're doing is worth their time, basically. And, I mean, really a lot of the stories for Shin Megami Tensei are the same, you know? It's just like, the world's coming to an end, and you have the power to commune with demons, and you can fight demons, and maybe you're part demon or something. So, just a lot of that going on. Just classic turn-based JRPG battle system with weaknesses and turn order, and exploiting their weaknesses gets you extra turns. So if you got the right lineup of demons on your team, you can essentially just go non-stop without ever giving them the chance to attack and just completely kill them. It's way hard. Well, not way hard, but it's way harder than something like Pokemon would be. Oh! You can fuse demons together. I probably should mention that. Fusing demons together to create more powerful ones. Now, this game doesn't have the best graphics, I guess. And there's times when you'll see a demon and his textures haven't completely loaded. It has issues like that. The story's not particularly interesting. I mean, it's okay. It's the same kind of stuff. End of the world. Go on. Fight gods and pick between well, not really pick, but get a various ending depending on how you chose to do things throughout the story. Good ending, bad ending, neutral ending, blah, 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 blah. I don't know. Just a good old time.
Number two in the list, Link's Awakening. And I remember an argument I got into online over this game. They were like, you could have just went on your 3DS and downloaded the original for like $10. And I'm like, I realize that, but I also realize that the original isn't as great as everybody remembers it being. Like, the original had limitations. This does not have limitations anymore. Is there the occasional, like, lag? Yeah, but I actually don't mind it. It's funny because I did the same strats that I did back in the day playing Link's Awakening, was to basically get as many rupees as I could. I would have all these things up here, like bows, a shovel, all this stuff. And I would just go up there and I would end up having enough money to buy it, because the rupee wallet in the game, in this game it's different. In the original, like, you can only have like 999, and I think the bow was like 980 or something. Yeah, like, that was pretty much what I would do. I would go and buy like all these. It's not even supposed to be late game. It's like, you're not really supposed to get this right now, but okay. And I would just do that. And this game, to me, though, is probably one of the better Zelda games. I'm glad they remade this. Like, people are still hoping, myself included, that they're going to remake the Oracle games for the Game Boy Color. If they don't, it would be weird. If they do, I hope it's, I don't want to say one for one or identical or everything, but, like, just this style is very unique, and it feels very Zelda-ish now. Like, I know a lot of people who still won't play this game because they don't like the designs, but I'm just like, just play it. Like, it's not gonna kill you just because it's not, oh, you know, blood, guts, and all this other stuff, edgy, and My Chemical Romance, and Brad gets the joke because he's gonna be like, ha, yeah. But, like, as people want to be like, oh, Zelda games should be dark, and I don't disagree, but at the same time, like, what part, aside from a whole island of people disappearing, is dark about this game? Because it's not much. But yeah, Link's Awakening is, I recommend it for everybody. I do, because, like, if you want something to waste 2-3 hours, maybe more, I don't remember how long it took me to beat this. I would say a couple days it took me, because I wasn't playing all the way through. But I recommend it. Like, get it for somebody for Christmas, do whatever, because, like, it's a great game. But, yep. Time to go.
Coming in at number two will definitely be Pokemon Sword and Shield. You know, I like this game, especially since it's the first Switch Pokemon game we got. And, you know, it takes a massive curveball from the traditions, and some may not like that, but it's kind of refreshing. I found all the new areas to be pleasing. A few that really stood out, you know, was the Mushroom Forest and the woods. You know, and it's got some very interesting new Pokemon. I don't typically use the new Pokemon. Some were really weak. But they just felt nice. As for the gyms, you know, nothing gets you pumped up more than a massive stadium of people cheering you on as an enormous-sized Pokemon battles it out and are taking absolute banger of a soundtrack is playing. Another thing, the soundtrack is so good. I cannot express how it made me feel. I felt pumped in gym battles. Or I was swept in by the Dreary Force slight melody. If this wasn't enough, I've still got more. Battles are so nice in this game. I find that the combat just rolls and rolls and never stops. Just constantly being caught up in a battle or story. And if you're not doing that, you're decking out your character's sweet looks at the clothing store. And to top it off, the characters are flowing with personality. It's insane how much they differ. And I found all of them likable, except for Leon, Bay. The only thing that isn't amazing in this game is the story, but I still find it quite entertaining. Definitely get it if you're a fan or just want to play a Pokemon game. But yeah, that's why it's my number two. I only put in like, I don't know, 80 hours in this game.
Number 2, The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. Now, I'm not going to stand here and tell you that I'm the biggest Zelda fan in the world, but I do really like Twilight Princess, and I'd really like Wind Waker. But Breath of the Wild is definitely the best Zelda, in my opinion. The thing about the way Breath of the Wild is designed, and just the constant of new discovery over every little hill, even if it's something small, like a Korok seed. Is it a Korok seed? The tree people. Even if it's like the little tree people seed, there's always something just over the hill. I don't know, something about it. It looks beautiful. It's the music is fantastic. It's really smooth and calming. I just really liked exploring the world. It was so interesting seeing this, like, not post-apocalyptic, but like, I guess you could say that, kind of like ruins everywhere, humanities and other races scattered to their relative corners of the world, and just like nothing really in between, these vast openness, which is like tons of stuff to explore and like little things to find. Now, I do agree with a lot of people who say that there's too many of the little shrines to do, because there's a fuck ton, and I agree with that. But I mean, they don't take long, they're only a couple minutes each, really. And then, the lack of dungeons, where the closest thing to a dungeon is the Sacred Beast, and then the actual castle itself. Weapons breaking, a lot of people complained about that. I didn't mind the weapons breaking that much, and I feel like it's because something about your weapon shattering in your hand and then scrambling to pick one up off the ground to keep fighting. I wasn't a big fan of like opening the menu and grabbing a new weapon. I always try to pick one up off the ground from a dead enemy and avoid pausing as much as possible, and I think that really helped my experience with it. But really, when it comes down to like big open world adventure games like that, the thing I just love to do is explore. And they designed a world where over every hill there's a new thing to find. And I think that really helped with my enjoyment of it. That's all I got. I liked exploring the world. It was neat. Only thing that really could have made it better was a little bit more Midna.
Sword and Shield, Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl, Breath of the Wild, Final Fantasy VII, Dragon Quest XI is fantastic, Smash Ultimate, Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, Paper Mario Origami King, Pokemon Mystery Dungeon Remake, Xenoblade Chronicles 2. I become so numb, I can't feel you there. Become so tired, so much more than aware. I become
And as an honorable mention, before number one, I would have to say it's Pokemon Arceus. It brought a whole new, fresher outlook on Pokemon games and what they could be. And I enjoyed that. Battling, catching, making friends, just the characters, everything in the game was refreshed. And it's an honorable mention, so you should play it, definitely.
Alright, so my honorable mention is Animal Crossing. I really enjoy Animal Crossing. I love the way it looks. I love the real chill nature of it and stuff. But when you boil it down, my issue with it really is just the way the game's designed. It's ultimately the way it's designed is to be played in short spurts every day. You know? Because it uses a real-time clock, and not only can I not play video games every day, when I sit down to play a video game, I want to play it for a long time. There's only so much fruit to pick, bugs to catch, and fish to catch, and presents to give to your, villagers, I guess, before you've done it all, and there's nothing left to do today. It's like, well, come back tomorrow. It's like, well, I gotta fucking work tomorrow, so I can't. You know? So that's why it's an honorable mention. As much as I like it, it's just not designed in a way that is convenient for me.
Xenoblade Chronicles, Definitive Edition. I love this game. I've been trying to get Brad to play it for a good while now. Mainly because it's JRPG. It's a JRPG. Most people love or hate this franchise. And I'm confused as to how you could hate it, unless you just don't like JRPGs. The difference between Definitive and Original is Definitive has more of the quality has been changed for the better. Like, there's a lot of quality of life changes for it. And I respect that. I fully support that. Arts are the fun part about this game. Like real fun about it. You can level up your arts and make them stronger. Like, it's simple JRPG tropes, if you know what I mean. It's awesome. Like, you can literally spend hours just farming this stuff. Like, if you get in a big enough battle with, like, multiple enemies, just be careful when you're... Another one. Just be careful whenever you're doing that, because they can outnumber you and they will kill you. But, with that being said, 100%, I recommend this to anyone who calls themselves a JRPG fan who's never played this. If you've heard things like, oh, well, it's this, it's that. Real talk, just play it for yourself. Like, I wouldn't recommend something to somebody if I thought it was garbage. Like, I just wouldn't. I'd be like, well, it's not that great. This game is fantastic. It has the story in it is amazing. I love it. The gameplay in it, if the battle style, if you just saw what you saw and you're like, well, I don't know if I like that, because they auto-attack and it doesn't really do anything. But with that being said, guys, this is my list. This is everything. I gotta go to work. Yeah. Thank you guys for watching. Like, share, subscribe, do whatever you can. I 100% recommend everybody checking out these games. That's it. See you guys later.
So the first game that I ever got on the Switch was Breath of the Wild, and I really enjoyed it. And it had a lot of cool aspects that brought the Switch to life. It really made the Switch... The game was really meant for the Switch. You know, and I gotta say, that the story is great. I really like seeing the memories and how that tied into the story. You know, and how the whole open world plan really set itself off as a different Zelda game, where you could go wherever you wanted and do whatever you wanted first. If you didn't want to go and do any of your side quests and defeat the boss, you could literally just go to the castle, defeat the boss right off the bat. Try to, anyway. I've seen some people do it, but, you know, I like the fact that you cook in the game. That was pretty nice. The voice acting was great. The characters were great. Seeing Link and Zelda meet, and then, you know, having that sort of not really trusting Link at the beginning to trusting Link to help save her toward the end, that's pretty great. Overall, yeah, it's definitely a must play. You should definitely, if you haven't played this, you should definitely do it. It's definitely a completionist journey. Like, if you're a hardcore completionist, this will take you a while. There is a lot to do. Tons of armor, tons of weapons, tons of fucked up shit. That's just great. But yeah, that's why I like Breath of the Wild. That's why it's my number one.
And at number one, to the surprise of probably nobody, it's Pokemon. It's always Pokemon. Number one thing that Nintendo has their hand in for basically my entire life, Pokemon. And as much as I liked Arceus for trying new and different things, it's gotta be Sword and Shield. I've always just been a huge fan of Pokemon. Basically, every time the reason I bought my Switch was because Pokemon Sword Shield was coming out. I didn't own a Switch before that point, and I only bought it because those were coming out. I waited till the new Pokemon came out to even buy the fucking Switch to play it in the first place. Same thing with my 3DS. I bought the special edition Pokemon X and Y just because that was coming out. My DS, first game I got for it was Platinum. Game Boy Advance, first thing I got was, I think, Ruby. Hell, the very first game I got, that when my parents bought me my very first Game Boy Color, the first game I had was Pokemon Red. Every time a new Pokemon comes out, I get whatever console it was on just to play Pokemon. And I'm probably gonna continue to do that until they don't make Pokemon anymore. Pokemon has been a part of my life since I was like 3 years old, watching the anime, playing the games, and it's nostalgia, it's everything that everybody loves about things that they like. That's what I like about Pokemon. I don't really know how to get into this. Really, and like, Pokemon's really important to me in just the history of my life. The amount of friends that I've made and maintained through our mutual love of playing Pokemon and other things. But like, there are people who I would not be friends with if Pokemon didn't exist. So, I mean, Pokemon's gotta be my number one. Basically forever. Well, alright, I hope you enjoyed that list of I don't even fucking know how many games that we all like on our Nintendo Switches. Is there a game that you think we might like based off the things we gave, or games that you think that we like that are bad? Leave it in the comments below. Maybe a game that you think's really good that we didn't mention. Leave that down there too. you know, like, subscribe, do all that bullshit, and I don't know, just fucking watch our other crap. Bye. I gotta say, I'm pretty surprised that AJ didn't put Pokemon on his list with just the amount of hours he has put into it. It's kind of crazy. He has more hours in that than really anything else. AJ, what is this? AJ. AJ. Buddy. Seriously? Come on, dude. There's no need for this. Come on.